The study is about a new training form who may improve glycemic control and also pancreatic beta cell function. I think that developing or the causing of diabetes is of course many characteristic. Of course, as we have been heard today also about the food intake is a very hot issue, obesity also, but also of course training is one of the parameters that we should be aware about. Finally, of course, smoking, as we all may know. But in this this lecture, I would like to keep focused especially on exercise. And the reason to conduct this special high-intensity training program is that it has shown that the people have more enjoyable by doing this kind of training compared to normal, more moderate training. We know also the skeletal muscles, metabolics, and also oxidative capacity also have been increased, have been shown in several studies also regarding this kind of training. Glycemic control and also pancreatic function seems all to be improved with more intensive training, in fact. They have been shown that it has improved cardiovascular function, not surprising, and also that GLUT4 proteins and also for the mitochondria, the mitoprotein 2 have also been shown to be changed a lot during only 2 weeks of this kind of HIIT training. And of course, we know also, we have also been aware about that HIIT training may also increase the production of catecholamines, mainly dopamines, which may have a very beneficial effect, especially on the abdominal fat metabolism. So, and at the end, I can just say what is maybe the most important thing of it is that it's possible to do this kind of training for this group of patients here, because it's limited time, it's only half an hour it takes from you arrive to you go home. So you can do it very easily beside your work and also fit it in the daytime. So I think that's very important if you should have some succeed to treat this group of patients here. In this study, we will mainly look with this HIIT training, we mainly look into the beta cell function. We'll be looking at insulin sensitivity, how this may change during this intervention study. We look also at the increased fat metabolism. We'll do some DEXA scanning on this, and then there will also be some cardiovascular system. However, we don't have the time to go through this in this presentation. So the aim was to demonstrate the effect of 8 weeks of low volume, high intensive training, where we looked at a group of diabetes patients, mainly on glucose control and pancreatic beta cell function. And just not to go through much in detail, but there was in the diabetes group, there was 12 included. One was excluded before we start up, and then there was 11 going to the intervention study, and 10 was passing through the intervention. And then we have a match group of people without diabetes that have a tendency to have the metabolic syndrome, overweight, and the other characteristic, but no diabetes, of course. And there was 13 including, and everybody passed through the intervention here. The design of it, where we measured the first BMI, and we took some urine sample, we made the oral glucose tolerance testing, we made the ICG, we made the VO2 max, and we make a DEXA scan for the body composition, especially to look about how the fat composition was changing. And then they went into the intervention for 8 weeks. They were training three times a week, a half an hour only. They did this HIIT, this intervention, interval training, 10 times at 60 minutes. And then we, in the end, after the 8 weeks, we repeated all the measurements here again to see what happened during these 8 weeks. And here's some of the data from it. I will not go through just some of them, but we could see mainly it's people, the groups, both of the healthy subject and those with diabetes. There was, you see, people in the 50s that was included here. What we could see about the blood pressure, both the systolic and diastolic blood pressure, was in fact that we could see a significant decrease. Also, even here in the diabetes group, here, even they were on medication for high blood pressure. And just to mention, we could see the VO2 max were also major changes. Only those 8 weeks here, significant decrease. And even when we modulate for the weight lost, we could also see that they still have very nice, significant difference here after the intervention here with the VO2 max here. I'll go through some of the data here with some figures. The hemoglobin A1C, we could see there was no significant difference from start to end in the group without diabetes. And the group with diabetes here, you could see there was a significant difference here in the hemoglobin A1C. And when we looked at the fasting blood glucose, as plasma glucose, we could see there was no, and not expected either, of course, a difference here in the healthy group, while the group with diabetes, we could observe a significant difference and decrease in the blood glucose levels. When we did the oral glucose tolerance testing, we could see after the 2 hours test that the blood glucose was unchanged in the control group, and it was decreased in the group with diabetes. And when we did the oral glucose tolerance testing, we also measured the area under the curve. And here we could see there was no difference here in the control group. That was also maybe a little bit expected. But in the group with type 2 diabetes, we could see there were many points here where there were significant differences. However, due to lack of power, we were not able to demonstrate a significant difference, but there is a tendency that there was being decreased during this 8 week of intervention here. We measured all the first phase also of glucose, and here there was a particular with a group with type 2 diabetes, there was a decrease here for this group here. And also when we measured the HOMA insulin resistant, we could also see very clearly that there was a significant decrease in the group with diabetes and no difference in the control group. Finally, we also made a HOMA beta cell function analysis, and there we also could see we saw an improvement here of the beta cell function, who was significant in the diabetes group, while in the control group it was an increase but was not significant. We also measured the oral disposition index, and here we could in fact see an increase in the diabetes group about 33% and no difference in the control group. And when we by the DEXA scan could observe what happened with our abdominal fat, we could see there was a very nice decrease, particularly in the diabetes group, which was highly significant, while there also was a significant difference in the control group also. And this was also matched with the waist, and there we could also see that it was decreasing also maybe more pronounced in the type 2 diabetes group. So out of this, we concluded that we could see, particularly in the diabetes patients, that there was a decrease in the insulin resistant, and also we can see an improvement of the beta cell function. There we could see that the hyperglycemia was also improved, and especially we could see the first phase of glucose after the first 30 minutes after the intake of the glucose load, that there was a particular decreased in the type 2 diabetes group here. And also we could see that the fasting plasma glucose after the oral DGT test was decreased in the diabetes group, while there was no difference in the control group without diabetes. And finally, the abdominal fat mass loss was also decreased, and also the waist was minimized in the diabetes group, but also we saw some nice results, in fact, also in the control group. So what we can extend out of this is that maybe this new training method maybe be interesting, especially to make new strategic ways of training diabetes patients. And it could be inspired to a new change of guidelines for training diabetes patients. We're still going on with some analysis at the moment. If we look at information, that's what we're doing now. Particularly, we're looking into circulating cytokines and different kinds. We also look at the vascular function, epithelium-dependent flow, mediated deletions that we're also looking at the moment, which we may hope also we can demonstrate that at this way around that we may avoiding and delay the case for amputation of this group of patients here, which have about 80 times higher risk of amputation than the normal population. Thank you very much for your attention.